Good morning, it's June 7th, 2020, and we're celebrating the Most Holy Trinity weekend here at Our Lady of Consolation Parish in Wayne, New Jersey. Thank you for joining us for our virtual Mass this weekend. Our celebrant is our pastor, Father Michael Lombardo, and we'll begin with glory and praise to our God.
Glory and praise to our God, who alone gives light to our days. Many are the blessings he bears to those who trust in his ways. We, the daughters and sons of him who built the valleys and plains, praise the wonders our God has done in every heart that sings. Glory and praise to our God, who alone gives light to our days. Many are the blessings he bears to those who trust in his ways. In his wisdom he strengthens us like gold that's tested in fire. Though the power of sin prevails, our God is there to save. Glory and praise to our God, who alone gives light to our days. Many are the blessings he bears to those who trust in his ways.
In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God as Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. And I welcome you, my friends, wherever you are. We have found ourselves being viewed in some very faraway places, Trinidad, Tobago, and Hawaii. So from around the world, welcome to our humble home. I ask you now to place yourselves in the presence of the God who made us. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, bring us to everlasting life.
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you. We give you thanks for your great glory, Lord God, heavenly King. O God, almighty Father, Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Have mercy on us. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in the glory of God the Father. Amen.
God our Father, who by sending into the world the word of truth and the spirit of sanctification, made known to the human race by your wondrous mystery, grant us, we pray, that in professing the true faith, we may acknowledge the Trinity of eternal glory and adore your unity, powerful in majesty, through Christ our Lord, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the book of Exodus. Early in the morning, Moses went up Mount Sinai, as the Lord had commanded him, taking with him the two stone tablets. Having come down in a cloud, the Lord stood with Moses there and proclaimed his name, Lord. Thus the Lord passed before him and cried out, the Lord, a merciful and gracious God, slow to anger and rich in kindness and fidelity. Moses at once bowed down to the ground in worship. Then he said, if I find favor with you, Lord, do come along in our company. This is indeed a stiff-necked people. Yet pardon our wickedness and sins and receive us as your own. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Praiseworthy and exalted above all forever. And blessed is your holy and glorious name. Praiseworthy and exalted above all for all ages. Glory and praise forever. Blessed are you in the temple of your holy glory. Praiseworthy and glorious above all forever. Glory and praise forever. Blessed are you on the throne of your kingdom. Praiseworthy and exalted above all forever. Blessed are you who look into the depths from your throne upon the cherubim. Praiseworthy and exalted above all forever. Glory and praise forever.
A reading from the second letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, rejoice, mend your ways, encourage one another, agree with one another, live in peace, and the God of love and peace will be with you. Greet one another with a holy kiss. All the holy ones greet you. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with all of you. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
God who is, who was, and who is to come.
Alleluia, 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 alleluia.
The Lord be with you and with your spirit. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Glory to you, O Lord. God so loved the world, he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him might not perish, but might have everlasting life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. Whoever believes in him will not be condemned, because he has not believed in the name of the only Son of God. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. So, my friends, we come to the end of the Easter season, the beginning of what we call ordinary time. But what I want to share with you are my own thoughts, that there's nothing ordinary, really, about any time. Because every day that you and I are alive is extraordinary. Every day that we get to act in the world and upon the world is extraordinary. Because we can make a difference. We can bring all the gifts we have in our hearts to fruition in the world in any way we choose. And that is so important, because that's what God wants us to do. And we are reminded today on the Feast of the Holy Trinity that God has been active in every age. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Pentecost, Jesus breathes upon them and says, "Receive the Holy Spirit." And the Holy Spirit continues to guide us, guide our church. God was with the Israelites throughout their history and still is. The Son is with us in the tabernacle, in the Eucharist, and in our hearts. Holy Spirit continues to guide us. And so when we talk about the notion that Easter is ended and we get into ordinary time, and I said to you before, there's nothing ordinary about it, I meant that. Because we are, in a way, launched into the world at the end of the Easter season as disciples in Christ. Because what does Jesus say to them, sending them out into the world? "As the Father has sent me, I send you." All the stories of Christ post-resurrection are all about comforting, consoling, and sending the disciples out into the world in as fearless a way as possible. And that continues on to this very day. So there's nothing ordinary about ordinary time. And we are going out into the world with the notion that we really are saved. We are saved. God sent his Son into the world to save the world. And so we are saved. That should be a great reason to get up every morning. And as I always say, say thank you to God. Thank you, God, for saving me. Because we are saved, and that's what God wants. God doesn't want the world to fall apart. God wants the world to be saved. And that's part of today's gospel, but it's also part of our psyche and our soul. It's part of who we are as people of God, saved people being out in the world to make a difference. And Paul does that in the reading today too. He says exactly the same thing when he sends them out with a very familiar kind of blessing and doxology that we use. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God his Father, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Now go. Right? Now go out into the world and save the world. And that's where you and I have every reason to rejoice, because of that sending forth, because of what the gospel says today. And at the end of it, of course, there is a reminder about eternal life, that not only are we saved, but we are also promised that there is more than this. We are out in the world to remake the world in the image of our Lord Jesus Christ, to walk in persona Christi, in the person of Christ. But we also know that walk in the person of Christ that we take never ends, that we walk with Christ both here and to the great beyond. And that is so very important, because there is so much more than what we see. And that's what Jesus came to reveal to us. And God knew that it had to be someone like us Or we might not believe it. And so we do believe that there is more than this. This morning I attended to a graveside service of a wonderful and beautiful woman from this parish, Irmgard. And Irmgard was quite up in years, had lived an incredible life. But as I stood there looking at the photograph that one of the family members brought, I saw that smiling face that I saw every Sunday morning for the past 20 years. That smiling face that came in through the side door of this church. And as Irmgard grew older, her stoop and her back continued to bend her over so that she had to walk in a kind of a little like this all the time. And her health began to really compromise her as the years passed. And I know that there had to be some kind of pain and disability mixed in with all of that. But when she came in that side door, every single Sunday morning, every 8 o'clock mass, she was always smiling. She was always saying, "Good morning, Father Mike, how are you?" She was always up, because in her heart, as in the hearts, I hope, of everyone I'm speaking to, and I know in my own heart, is the knowledge that even though age and time may take its toll on us, we should continue to find it in our hearts to smile every day, because we are saved. Irmgard knew that. She came to church to receive the body and blood of our Lord and to celebrate her salvation in the midst of this parish community. And that's what made her so beautiful, such a shining example of what it is to be part of a community. That's why it's so important for us to worship together. And I take this moment and this opportunity to share some very personal thoughts about that. I think some of the reason why people are in the world and very often aggressive and not always watching out for each other, although I think that has been truly tempered, and I think people have improved because of the crisis that we've been in, but all too often the rushing around on the roads and in our lives and where we work, to what end? And the disregard for others. And I think so much of it is because, and I say this with conviction, people don't go to church. People don't spend 45 minutes a week in their church, in their synagogue, in their house of worship, whatever you want to call it, in quiet prayer and meditation, that there are others in the world beside yourself. You're not the only one. It becomes so easy to be isolated in homes and in cars and in our own little world that the rest of the world, well, they're out there, but that's not my concern. That's one of the most tangible benefits of a parish getting together and worshiping together. And I think that's why we miss it so much. And we've missed it for the entire Easter season. I hope one of the positive things that comes out of this medical crisis is that more people go back to church. Is that more people see the parish community or their worship community, whatever it is, as a source of solace, of comfort, as a source of togetherness, and a recognition that we are all children of God, which all too often seems to fall away the moment we get behind the wheel, or the moment that people get in our way, or the moment that we're somewhat challenged by bad behavior out in the world. It all seems to disappear. And remember what I always say, church is easy, life is hard. It begins when you go out the door. This is easy, my friends. This is scripted. I have my role to play and you have yours. And we come together and our ritual binds us. We know the proper responses. And then with a final blessing and sending forth, it's over. 45 minutes, maybe an hour. That's why it should be a place where more people come, because it's not that much time out of the week. But oh, what a gift it is. What a gift. We're saved. Why not come to church for 45 minutes? You're saved by the body and blood of Jesus Christ. You're saved by Christ, his sacrifice on the cross. Why not come to a place for some small period of time to be with your brothers and sisters and to bow down and humble ourselves before God? I hope truly that more people have come to an awareness of that because of what we've gone through. And it's doubly important, and sometimes you wonder what God's purpose is in all of this, that we were deprived of Easter season. We were deprived of the most important part of the liturgical year, deprived of the most important, the most important aspect of our whole faith experience, which is the resurrection of our Lord, which is Easter, and the Easter Sundays that follow, that we celebrate together. We were deprived of that. And now we go into what we call ordinary time, but there's nothing ordinary about it, as I said before. It is a time of sending forth into the world. And once again, now that we are able to go out into the world, now that the height of the crisis seems to have abated, how will we go out in the world after quarantining and sheltering at home and kind of pulling into ourselves, experiencing family in more intimate and more positive ways, now that we can go out in the world a little more and a little bit more? How will we do that? How are we going to go out into the world? Well, have a suggestion on Trinity Sunday. Go out into the world, not as a man, a woman, a child. Go out into the world as first and foremost children of God. That's how we should reemerge from our cocoons and our isolation. Reemerge, look up, see the sky, and say, there is more to me than this flesh and blood, which will grow old. There is rather the Holy Spirit dwelling within me, especially on this Trinity Sunday, empowering me to go forth into the world and act upon the world as a disciple, as a child of God. Not just to reemerge and say, wow, thank God that kind of that is all coming to an end right now. Don't think of it that way. Think of it as a new beginning for you personally. If you've been watching me, and if you've been listening to the Gospels, and if you've been praying every day and kind of going through what you know you need to do in terms of a prayer life and a God in you life, well, now what are you going to do? Because now you can go outside and we get to mingle a little bit more and gradually reemerge. How are we going to reemerge? I leave that with you, my friends. I could really go on and on about it. To all of my folks who watch me and who know my usual fallback sayings, you've heard them all before. The thank you prayer in the morning, reemerge as a child of God, and know that you're empowered as a disciple of the Lord. That's really what the Easter season is all about. We read about it in all of the readings, how the disciples and the apostles were gradually, through the appearances of Christ, raised up, nurtured. They were healed of their fear, and they were sent forth. Doesn't that sound strangely familiar about what we've all been through since the virus took hold? Really? So why not kind of reemerge, not only in a world that hopefully we'll be able to put this crisis to bed, but reemerge again, I know, reemerge as children of God. Take care, my friends. May the Lord, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit bless you abundantly on this Trinity Sunday, and I'll see you next time. Joining me, my friends, as we profess the faith that we love. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell on the third day. He rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. Our response is, hear us.
For those who need our prayers, and all those who have asked us to pray for them, and all whose names appear on the sick list in the parish bulletin, may God fill their lives with healing and peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear us. Jesus, during your ministry on earth, you showed your power by caring, healing people of all ages and stations of life from physical, mental, and spiritual ailments. Be present now to people who need your loving touch because of COVID-19. May they feel your power of healing through the care of doctors and nurses. Lord, in your mercy, hear us. Take away the fear and anxiety and feelings of isolation from people receiving treatment under quarantine. Give them a sense of purpose in pursuing health and protecting others from exposure to the disease. Protect their families and friends and bring peace to all who love them. Lord, in your mercy, hear us. Dear Lord, we lift to you our concern for people who are more likely than others to become ill from COVID-19, the elderly, and people with chronic health conditions. Protect them from harm and be their comfort in this time of uncertainty, and for many, preventative isolation from loved ones. Lord, in your mercy, hear us. Lord God, thank you for your courageous men and women who have chosen such difficult and dangerous jobs, police, fire, EMTs, and others. Thank you for their sacrifice and service. Thank you for their hard work in training and preparing. Help them to feel the respect and the gratitude of their communities in Jesus' name. Lord, in your mercy, hear us. For all who have died to rise with Christ in eternal light, especially Italina Citro and Bernice Kelly, Art Gallagher, John Chiricella, Pat Felsman, Linda Nice, Tony Borowskis, Joe Borez, Nelda Burke, Victoria and Michael Szymanski, for whom this Mass is offered. Lord, in your mercy, hear us.
Let us pray. Holy and loving God, you raised your Son from death in the tomb. Hear us and give answer through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
pray, my brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church. And let us pray. Sanctified by the invocation of your name, we pray, O Lord our God, this oblation of our service, and by it make of us an eternal offering to you, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you and with your spirit. Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and just. It is truly right and just, our duty and salvation always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, humble and eternal God. For with your only begotten Son and the Holy Spirit, you are one God, one Lord, not in the unity of a single person, but in a trinity of one substance. For what you have revealed to us of your glory, we believe equally of your Son and that of the Holy Spirit, so that, in the confessing of the true and eternal Godhead, you might be adored in what is proper to each person, their unity in substance and their equality in majesty. For this is praised by angels and saints, cherubim too, and seraphim, who never cease to cry out each day, as with one voice they acclaim.
Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest.
You are indeed holy, O Lord. You are the font of holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending your Spirit upon them, that they become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks you've held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we will be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world. Bring us together in charity with Francis our Pope, Arthur our Bishop, clergy, religious, the entire people your Son has gained for you. Remember also, brothers and sisters, who have fallen asleep in the hope of resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy, welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, with the Blessed Virgin Mary, the Mother of God, her beloved husband Joseph, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, that we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may always be free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours forever and ever. Amen. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "My peace I give you, my peace I leave with you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church. Graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, where you live and reign forever and ever. May the peace of the Lord be with you always. My friends, wherever you are, share a sign of peace with those close to you, those you love."
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Grant us peace.
Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. May the body of Christ keep me safe for eternal life. May the blood of Christ keep me safe for eternal life. Thank you. Let us pray. May receiving this sacrament, O Lord our God, bring us health of body and soul as we confess your eternal Holy Trinity and undivided unity through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you and with your spirit. May Almighty God bless us, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Before we go, my friends, we have some milestone announcements to share with you. This one concerns the Ermeer family, who have been lifelong parishioners here. Serena Indigo Ermeer graduated Castleton University, bachelor's degree in athletic training. We congratulate her. And her brother Tristan, Gabriel Ermeer, who graduated the College of New Jersey last May, Officers Candidate School April 17th, and Ensign in the United States Navy, Charleston, South Carolina. I baptized both of you. I love you very much, and I wish you both well. A shout out to our dear friend Eleanor Ermeer, their grandmother, who I'm sure is watching and beaming. God bless the entire Ermeer family. My sincere condolences to the Bandola family on the loss of their mother. May she rest in peace. I know the Bandola family watches our Sunday Mass from their home in Hawaii, and we don't have a picture of them, but we certainly found one of Hawaii. Many of you have asked about the status of my mom, Dorothy. She is on hospice and living with me at the rectory. At the present, she is doing well as can be expected given the nature of her disease process, her Alzheimer's. Thank you to everyone who has inquired as to her health. I'd like to mention all the caregivers dealing with elderly and frail parents, especially during the last few months. I am fortunate to see my mother every day. However, I feel for those parishioners whose parents are in nursing homes. They are unable to see them since March 8th, when the institutions were closed to visitors. Two of our parishioners share a birthday, Gabe Vitalone and Len DeBlaker. We wish Gabe a happy birthday. We won't say how many years, but he is one of our senior parishioners. He is a World War II veteran, graduate of Fordham, a poet, and so many other things to so many people and much beloved. Len DeBlaker graduated William Paterson University, bachelor's degree, environmental science. And for both of you, best wishes. It's brought to my attention that many of our parishioners send us their photographs and the information that they want us to be able to put forward, but it often comes too late. So please send it to us as early as possible. Finally, you see we have happy stones on the altar representing parishioners' feelings these days. That's a good thing considering what we are going through. Following the end of our Mass today, we have two videos for you. One of a little tour we took through Lion's Head Lake, where a great many of our parishioners reside. The other one from our youth group, who want to say thank you in their own very special way. And finally, my friends, I want to share with you some thoughts about the events in our nation this past week and the tragic death of George Floyd. I'm going to explore a number of aspects of the issues surrounding this tragedy in my morning reflections this week. The sermon today was about discipleship. The sermon today was about going forth in the world and making a difference. Many people today are making a difference in our world, and I commend them for that. People who peacefully demonstrate make a difference. Police officers everywhere doing their job make a difference. But tragic things happen not only in our nation, but around the world. And when those tragedies involve the loss of human life, we are all responsible. As I said before, God wants the world to be a place of discipleship and of peace. And whenever there is an unnecessary and tragic loss of life that in some way could have been prevented, it hangs heavily on all of our shoulders, not only here, but around the world. And so, my friends, in the words of the sermon that I gave you today, be good disciples in the vineyard of life. Go forth to nurture life. Live your faith. Be that Christ who was a healer and a forgiver. And most of all, and most of what we need right now, be peacemakers, because the world is in desperate need of it. not only in our nation roiled by these events, but around the world. There is too much unnecessary loss of life. And oftentimes, we stand by. We feel we are powerless, but we're not. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost resides with us, empowering us in the name of Christ to make a difference in the world that might someday bring true and lasting peace. Go in peace, my friends, to love and serve the Lord and one another. And may God travel with you very well this week. Make a difference.
Let there be peace on earth, and let it begin with me. Let there be peace on earth, the peace that was meant to be. With God as our Father, brothers all are we. Let me walk with my brother in perfect harmony. Let peace begin with me. Let this be the moment now. With every step I take, let this be my solemn vow, to take each moment and live each moment in peace eternally. Let there be peace on earth, and let it begin.
Put my mask on, so for those of you who might see this, don't worry. I'm not anywhere close to anybody, except the kid with the camera. We're going to tour around Lion's Head Lake today, and I want to thank Tori Trenicourt, her husband, Fire Chief Pat, for getting this all together, and all these wonderful parishioners who came together today so that we could share our love and our affection for our parishioners on that end of town.
Morning, everybody. My name is Victoria Trentacos. I am the parish manager here at Our Lady of Consolation Church. This morning, we're doing a caravan with our parishioners through Lion's Head Lake to bring some cheer to our parishioners and their neighbors.
We're really happy to be doing this and go out and make a little connection with our OLC family, let them know that we're here for them and we're thinking about them, and God gave us a beautiful day to do this. So we're hoping it makes everybody have a happy day and feel a little bit more connected.
This is an important occasion. I think there's so many people who give their time and energy to a good cause and to help out during this time of considerable crisis.
I'm happy to be joining in this caravan this morning to bring smiles and joy to the people of our parish. I, along with everyone else, look forward to seeing you in church soon, because I truly miss going to Mass and seeing all my friends and church family there. I'm thrilled to be doing this. I feel anybody by themselves or at home by themselves, this is going to bring them a little bit of joy, and anything we can do to help one another at this stage of the game, I think is so important.